Greetings, family, and salutations to all God's wonderful people. Challenges and more challenges, says Apostle Richie. What can I say unto the Lord? I am the Lord. Help me sing this one. That healeth thee. I am the Lord. Your healer, I send my word and heal your disease. I am the Lord, your healer.
Mark chapter 11, verse 7.
I am the Lord that healeth you. I am the Lord. Your healer, I send my word and heal your disease. I am the Lord, your healer.
One more time, please sing it with me. Say,
I am the Lord that healeth thee. I am the Lord. Your healer, I send my word and heal your disease. I am the Lord, your healer.
My topic of today's address is, I shall not be convinced against my work and purpose. I shall not be convinced against my work and purpose.
I am the Lord that healeth thee. I am the Lord, your healer. I send my word and heal your disease. I am the Lord. Your healer. I sent my word and healed your disease. I am the Lord, your healer. And
cast their garments
on him and sat on him. Hallelujah. Bless your name, Jesus.
Okay, she say yes. Okay,
no, praise the Lord.
It is on. All right, let's start again. And they brought the colt to Jesus. You read?
And cast their garments on him and sat on him.
Amen. Hallelujah. Are we all good now? Everything is all right? Let's sing the song one more time.
I am the Lord that healeth thee. I am the Lord, your healer. I send my word. And heal your disease. I am the Lord, your healer.
Hallelujah to Jesus. Father, please continue to bless your word unto our hearts and glorify your name. In Jesus' name. Amen. Every opposition, every distractions, every hurt, every doubt, and every feeling of discomfort, we are going to throw them into a bucket called disease. And we are going to allow Jesus to sit upon every one of our newest revelations. If you would have been reading Mark chapter 11, you would have seen that they came to this particular place not having knowledge of what Jesus was up to and about to do. Jesus had a bag of tricks and revelations that was going to blow them into the orbit of their newness of liberty. And Jesus sent two of his disciples. And let me just tell you that when the call of the Lord is upon one's life, don't be too quick to challenge them, to change what they have said before. It's better to pray with them, to upgrade your understanding of what they are saying, instead of immediately telling them that they are mad. So they should get out of here because they're mad. Because many of us have missed great revelation sometimes. As a matter of fact, there are some people who would have had words from the Lord that they would have gone to one company, the company that they are most comfortable with, to share with them and to chase them out. And they went to another company. And the rest is history. Awesome things came out of that. Books, movies, history, great things happen. So that's the topic. I shall not be convinced against my work and purpose. And a subtopic, I shall not be convinced against my higher calling in Christ. Your lack of preparation, write it down. Your lack of preparation not only should not, but does not dictate an emergency for me. It is not my responsibility to prove to you that Jesus is Lord. I know that many religious people will disagree with me with that, but I pray for them. It's not my responsibility to convince you that Jesus is Lord. I am presenting to deliver my soul. I have one part of the program to accomplish, and you have the other part. If I'm not lazing out my part by not presenting, and now I'm talking to the nearest and dearest people and persons in my life, it's not because I don't like you, I talk to you like this. It's because I love you. And I hope that you love me back. If I didn't lazy out my responsibility in refusing to make the presentation, then you should not lazy out your responsibility to receive the message, put it on the grill, or the crank crank, and allow the rhema word, the particular, because not everything is that is presented, not all of that can fit into your program. But when you wait before the Lord with it, he comes and give you specifics as to how you operate. Apostle Stuart and I are going to do some cut and paste later on in the message, okay? And to fulfill what is the word of the Lord for today. But I'm going to share a testimony with you. Yesterday, I in passing through one of those rest stops that a friend of mine owned, I always stopped there, not only to refresh myself, but to support him. And I saw a lady She was one of those ladies who sell out of her car. And she was fumbling around with... Why I saw her is because she had things up on the different parts of the car. And then when I was coming back from where I went, I stopped again. This time now was to get some food, really refresh myself. And I noticed after I was finished that the lady was on the other side of the car park. And I went to her and asked her if she had a particular piece of clothing that I wouldn't mind purchasing. I want to tell you that later on in the conversation, the lady said, I don't think you came for that. I think the Lord led you to this situation. And I noticed some obvious things about her discomfort as you were standing here. So I asked her, I said, what's the story? She said, story? How you know? I said, how do I know what? She said, the story. I said, that's why I'm asking you. I don't know it yet. I said, and she started to cry and started to explain some things. And I said, okay. You know, like, oh, equalize, I'll do it. I said, okay, you have 7 minutes. You have 7 minutes to tell me the story. It's a long story, but the long and short of it is that I ended up spending about 2 hours and 7 minutes with her. And why we spend so much time is that I recognize that I was needed to manage a particular area of grief without any knowledge of the situation or even the lady. I turned up, saw her twice, challenged her the second time, and ended up exporting what we are strong in. So I'm saying to the AWC family, deliver your soul by exporting what you know. Don't just learn and question and wonder if I'm mad. But put it before the Lord. Let him give you your particular area to function in, and export what you know. Thus, I am seeing the thing coming together when he says, I come to give you. I live to give you. So I live to give you, you live to give somebody else, and we are always going to find people, not only with grief, but that we are strong in. Right? Hello? That I am strong in, that we are strong in, that we do not have to. And I'm going to go, that's why Uncle Stewie and I are going to cut and paste some things to really relate what it is that we are talking about. We can't just sit in one place and compare the things that we are hearing and receiving and wonder if anything can go so. We have to tell somebody else, make them marvel over it. Amen? All right. So I shall not be convinced against my work and purpose. Give up, don't test. You can't convince me against my work and purpose. I recognize my higher calling in Christ. And I'm going to keep pumping it until Jesus say move on. Amen. To convince is to logically. And when that word comes in, it kills the opponent's point. To convince is to logically persuade one from his or her belief. There is no, my belief system is well compacted. There's no space for logics. So if trying to persuade me not to believe what I believe, it's an exercise in futility. I give you two. Firstly, a statement of authority. I refuse to talk around to try to make people feel good in their error. I refuse to talk around the bush because some of us know better. But to allow the people that are opposing to not feel so bad, we talk around the bush with them. We are not helping the people when we do that. So that's my statement of authority. My statement of power is next. Having served my time and paid my dues, I refuse to be convinced to come off my pursuit of my higher calling in Christ. Power statement. Now, if your business is evil and fear, whoever you may be, and I'm saying this, I'm making the statement for my family to be able to adopt that and use it against the opposition too, not necessarily just talking to you, the members of the choir. If your business is fear and evil, the Spirit of the Lord God is upon me to recognize that you are bereft of power. You are bereft of substance. And you are bereft of authority. So I shall treat you likewise. Family, listen to this. If you're afraid of what seems to be evil, you are weakening that statement that I just made. If you're afraid of what seems to be fear, then you are not living, you are not punching to the optimum of who you are as a child of God. If dopey frighten you, you're weak. If the words of an arrogant person push you off your stand, you're weak. If the enemy decides to show you that you're weak and you succumb, you're weak. If grief mash you down, you're weak. And so, between the presentation of Pastor Stewart and myself, I'm going to ask him now to come and testify. I see you, Likamura.
Hallelujah. Greetings to everyone.
Hallelujah.
I am thankful to the Lord for what he's been doing and the things that he has been saying and revealing to us through his servant, speaking and challenging our hearts. And I was at work on Sunday, last Sunday, doing quite a number of things. And so I had my phone with me and I took it everywhere I went while the ministry was going forth. So everywhere I went, I found a spot to put it up so that I can listen and close enough, you know, to hear what the Lord was saying. And one of the things that stood out very vividly and potent as Senior Apostle was sharing his heart was on grief, because it was a week before that I went to a funeral service. And while I was there, the Lord was just bringing back some things that I have heard Senior Apostle speaking on grief. And one such thing that the Lord said to me that came back while he spoke last Sunday was that the Lord said to me at some time ago, do not become intimate with grief. And it was how the Lord put it was, it, I mean, the words that he used was very important. He said, do not become intimate. And we know what intimacy is, right? We know what intimacy is. And the Lord was putting it that strong. And then while I mused on it, the Lord said, go and read the scripture, because the Lord brought the scripture back to me in Isaiah, where it says that Jesus was a man of sorrow and acquainted with grief. And I said, Lord, Lord, what are you saying to me? What are you saying? And then the Lord started to show me some things. But while I was musing on what Senior Pastor said on Sunday, the Lord brought this part emphatically into my being and says, Jesus was a man of sorrow. And he had to be a man of sorrow for the purpose of identifying with us. Because all of us at some point have some sorrow that will come. And the sorrow can come whether it is self-inflicted or it is inflicted by external forces, if you want to use that word, or other people. Sorrow comes because of the condition of what took place when man fell. Sorrow comes. And Jesus Christ had to identify himself with us in order to empathize with us and to lift us. But him say, he was acquainted with grief. Acquainted. You know an acquaintance, right? You say you know him? You know him? No. Him is just an acquaintance. Not true. Yeah. You know, sometime every now and again, you know, but yeah, past you, but me not really know him. That is why you must treat grief. Right? Because grief prolonged or grief taken out of context within the situation is hopelessness. So you have some people grieving for years and God has said, look, I am acquainted with your sorrow. I know your sorrow. But if you decide that you want to go down the road with grief and walk all the way down and palsy with grief, then are you alone going to go down there? Because I cannot go down there with you. That's one of the cannot. Where God said, I can't go down there so with you. It's not that I don't have the ability or power to. But I can't go down there with you, else I will be going against my character. Because going down that road is hopeless. And I'm not going to palsy-walsy with you going down that road, because that's not in my nature and my character. That's not my work and purpose. So do not. And then while I was sitting there, the Lord said something, you know, with grief. Grief is like a safety valve. So something come and hit you. Grief is like an outlet, you know. I don't know how to put it, you know, but grief means that you're not taking the hurt. But you have to let it go. Because it serves just one purpose. You have to let it go. And then the Lord, when you brought out the point now, that you do not have to grieve. The Lord said, I take you up on a different level. That's where he's taking us. You don't have to grieve, none at all. Because the thing is, he's a man of sorrow. So I'm already identifying with you. And I'm already going through with you. And he is giving you, it's not just buffer God I give you, you know. And it's another buffer than a buffer God I buffer you, you know. He might place something in your spirit, in your heart, him take it. And make the way clear. Now that might sound harsh to some people who in them feelings. Can open them flesh. And then say, you can't be so harsh. But that is where God wants us to go. So that is one thing. And the second thing is, the second thing is that I remember I was sharing with my wife and we were talking about power. You know, when burial came, I remember waking up with the Lord. Like me and the Lord, they are talking and me sleep and me wake up and talk to him. I don't know if I explain it, but it's like, you know, you wake up and you talk. Yeah. And I remember the Lord said, in my power, in my wrath, I exercise love. Love is always present. Love is always dear. And you know, we were talking about power and, you know, it came up where, you know, remember the statement that is a statement that is used wide, you know, by all the scholars, many of them, where power corrupts and absolute power corrupts absolutely. But it's not true. The Lord speaking to me being, I said, look here, no man, don't worry that. That's one of the things we have to, you know, put aside and say, you know, yeah, we reach here, so now, yeah, so we'll leave it alone. Put that aside. Because the Lord said, look, I am the one who gives power. I give power to do what? To get wealth. Jesus said, all power is given unto me in heaven and in earth. Right? He authorized. And that's the other part that came to me as Sir was speaking. And so, why would God give something to us that would corrupt us? Think about it. Why would God give us something that would corrupt us? It means that God would have been corrupted. Because he would have a fundamental flaw in giving us something that can corrupt. And nothing that God gives to us corrupt us unless the vessel that is receiving it will corrupt himself or is corrupt or something. So the Lord gives us power to get wealth. And then I was looking at it, and when Sir said authority is the top boss over power, I just, oh God, Uranus, because can you imagine somebody having authority, having power and don't have any authority, think about what would happen. So when I was writing down, when the Lord was talking to me, I wrote, power without love is brutal. Brute beast. But love is God's ultimate expression. It is the sum total of his divine nature. Because God is love. And then, as I was speaking, all of those things, you know, I was just marveling, because it's like 2 weeks before, I was talking to a trainee, and I was sharing with her. And as her said, export what you have. I didn't hear it then, you know, but I was doing it. And when I hear you saying it, I said, oh my God, you know. And she was saying to me, you don't know. I mean, in doing, we're working, you know, but then may I put something, you know, Lord, I says, talk to her. And, you know, she had talked to me, and she came back at a certain point before she left, and she said, you really don't know what you have done for me, because it's not just, you taught me the job, and I'm so happy. And I asked the Lord to give me somebody who I can really relate to, because I was so nervous, and I'm saying, worry yourself, man, because God brought you to me because he knew what I went through, and he knew how I should handle you and how I must relate to you. And I spoke to her, and she said, you don't know, you say some things that is outside of the job, you know, but it is relevant to me in my situation, and you were saying some things, and I don't think you know what you said to me. And you know, she at the end of the thing, she gave me a postcard with, you know, and one of the things she was talking about was debt, and it's like she was thinking that debt was just going to, you know, just going to continue. And I said, no, debt only have a time. Jesus, debt and hell will be cast in the lake of fire. And she was looking at me, and I was saying to her, you can't die until the Lord and you make the arrangement. I was just encouraging her about that, you know. And, you know, I was looking at it and recognizing that I actually said to her, that is not really a part of God's intrinsic nature, you know. If you notice, all the fruits of the Spirit, you don't see that in it. You don't see, that came as a response of our disobedience. And then I heard you saying something that actually bring light to what I was saying when you said, and I can relate to that, you know, because the job that I'm doing, I can relate to it. Sir said, when people don't like themselves, them decide to cut off and put on and take off and cut on piece and do all sorts of things. And what happens is that it bring about a reaction, because things start go bad, because I know so God intended for go. Well, I see him so with debt. Debt come about not because God gave us debt. God never gave man debt. God is not the dead God of the dead, but the God of the living. He gave man life, but because man trifled with what he's supposed to leave alone, it brought forth death. But death is serving its purpose until such time when death, the last enemy that shall be defeated is what? Enemy. So death is not one of those intrinsic nature of God where God says, I have death and in my character is made up of. No. But it is in response to man's state and disobedience. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Because where there is sin, there will be death. And where there is sin, there will be wrath. But where there is love, where there is no sin, there is love. And where there is sin, let me get it right. Where there is sin, wrath is around the cross. Somewhere there. Where there is sin, death. But love covers a multitude of sin. And and where sin abound, grace did much more abound. So the love of God is always present, whether there is sin or whether there is any situation, because God is love. That is God's essential nature. Hallelujah. Everything else comes out of who he is when he went into himself. And God does not love us because Jesus died. I hear people say it, you know, but the other way around. God loves us before Jesus Christ died. That's why he died. Hallelujah.
God bless you. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Glory. Glory and honor and wisdom and power. All right, let me see what I can do. I've been received the baton for the anchor lead. They're running a nice relay. Amen. Hallelujah. Let me start by saying here, taking something from what piggybacking and something Stewie say. The measure of a man is what he thinks a woman, you know, he or she thinks they can do, because nobody can tell them not to do it. And probably nobody not seen, and nobody can take them down. That's, and they do what is righteous. That's the measure of a man. It is not it is not just because you function in a space where everybody expects you to function. But even when you have the rule, have the handle, you must be righteous. Amen. I want to strengthen this thing that I say about God reigning in power and authority. If we are not strident in our quest for peace through understanding and, you know, the rest, we might find ourselves accepting a parochial kind of authority from people who we rate, but not righteous people, and not God, but just people that we rate. So we can create some hell for ourselves sometimes, because of our likes and dislikes and laziness and whatever, apathy, we create some atmospheres that we expect the best is going to come from. Some of us would have had some opportunities to see pomp and pageantry. I have seen pomp and pageantry in some lights that it's mind-boggling. But pomp and pageantry and pretty can deceive. Folklore and myths are misguided efforts of props to deceive the simple. If you would have seen the opening presentation for the games, for the Olympics, there was a whole heap of myths and folklore thing in there to make up, to make it look majestic. So I'm going to tell you about real majesty. Those things don't support, those things can't prop up real majesty. They can look pretty, but real majesty is a chip off the divine block of authority.
When we admire His majesty in all His in all His glory, and our hearts are filled with Him, and not only what we think we understand from the Word, but His Word is living Word, even what we don't understand. The majesty of that, it comes out of a heart of, you know, being overwhelmed. We have so much, and it seems like we can't even manage what is coming. But that's the nature. That's the nature of who He is and what He does. That is righteous majesty, if I might call it that. Like everything else, the world seem to put up some pretty things to kind of call it majesty. But when we talk about the majesty of His majesty, King Jesus, I don't get the impression that many people who are called Christians are aware of the authority of the majestic presence of the Lord God. It's not just to do something and feel the flesh, feel a level of satisfaction for it. It's an admiration. And I mean, nobody else needs to be there. You alone can just stand up there. It's an admiration of the power and authority of God in majestic pursuit of getting our attention to know who we are and who we have as our Lord and Savior. The things that we get excited over, sports and games and entertainment and so on and so forth. I'm not hitting that and saying that's wrong. I'm sports and games fanatic. But I'm talking about lifting our gaze. When you see people choosing that over this, you know that they are bereft of understanding. Now, a little more on the grief thing. Let's look at the soul. If I ask you what you think the soul is, what would you say? Some words like the mind, the will. What is the next word? Now, it is biblically proven that we can accept that as a soul, but it's my personal belief that the soul is more than that. But we can work with that. Now, if emotions is in there, work with me. Deep sea diving, deep call it unto deep. If the emotion is in there, then we are going to equate it with the mind and the will. Can you control your mind and your will? Do you change your mind when you're ready? Come on, talk to me, family. It is a surrender of your will to the Lord that He works in us both to will and to do of His good pleasure. He doesn't get to work and doing things when we don't give Him permission. Do you know that the scripture says, the same scripture, just down a little more down from what Uncle Stuart was quoting, says that the Lord has taken our grief? So what are you doing with it, Peter? How comes you will still have it? The scripture said that Jesus take it. What were you still doing today? Just look at the mind and you see the sense. You're not even spirit, but the sense in what I'm saying. When things come to your mind, have you sinned? Answer the man. You process the thing and cuss out that and chase out that and this and throw out that. And some wonderful things come as a result of the management of your mind. So why you can't do that with grief? I was saying, I look here, the lady yesterday impressed me. Because I was saying to her, my grief management start with be real. Don't live in denial. That's the first thing you do. When you recognize, when you do your due diligence and recognize, say, grief is here. Because you have to do your due diligence, you have to ask question, is he dead? Tom Brady pushed Scar, shoulder off his head, if he's really dead. Now the hospital laid down on the bed. I may have to pull her away from there and say, he's dead. You have to do your due diligence. That was her due diligence she was doing to make sure she's really dead. Now, after you do it, due diligence, find out, say, yes, this grief is present. You have to be real with yourself and the situation. And being real is to say, even if you can't say nothing else, say Jesus. Because if you say Jesus, what you are really subscribing to is that him have the grief. You're giving him the part where you might did have a hold on to. It's your emotions, family. You can control your emotions. And if you think you can't control it, if you say you can't control it, I'm going to tell you you're not saved. Because being saved means surrendering your soul. Well, you notice the scripture don't say save your mind. Eh? You notice the Lord don't pick it out like that and so. The Lord says, save your soul. Save your soul. He's saving your mind. He's saving your will. He's saving your emotions. In other words, he is taking all of those and he's guarding. He puts a guard on it and he says, give me permission to be formed in you so that I can take your grief when it comes. So that if your emotion would be flashing all over the place, doing and saying all sorts of nonsense, I calm it down and put it in its rightful place. And the same emotion that I'm using, that you think you can control, me help you control it, and you put it in the place where some people see you afterward and them, and it that relatives them did, because I say, oh, our mother did and she laugh. A long time we had to do this thing, you know. Eh? Some of my family members, they mixed with me because when my mother died, I said, praise Jesus, hallelujah. Glory! Mama T gone home. Erica said she tired. She go home, Grace. Eh? You prefer to have this lady, 99-year-old, you're the goo-goo gaga, oh, Mama T, I love you, yeah, yeah, yeah. And then, are you alone? I enjoy yourself, and she not paying. Selfish. Not going on like them is Christian when it's just some little religious foolishness them know. And them ready figure have nine night and them ready figure, you know, do this and do that and some dinky mini, some something and all kind of nonsense. And a man says, so not now go on for Mama T. Me say, Mama T dead. You go on to your yard, go sing. Go on with your sankia, yeah, go sing, Mama T dead. Don't make me start preach now. In my mother. Not yours, me know her. I see me, when me born, when me was conscious enough to be able to know I go on Missy Mama Tia pray for me. Not talk about nobody else. She was praying for me. Eh? I am as a result of her prayer. Now, when I got to understand more about what God is saying about how this thing's supposed to go, I taught my mother how to appreciate it. She wasn't fussing about and doing foolishness, and some people when them dying and them can't manage them, them show them real colors, which is some ugly colors. And people say, I saw it go when people are dead, that's what them do. No nonsense. People folklore and all kind of nonsense and say, I used to this and used to that. But them here say your family dead and one line of mourners line up outside with some, I walk like them half dead with some book ready for sing. Remember one time somebody did that and them asked me for read the song with for sing. Them take the book from me. When me call out the song, how the song should be happy, them don't want that. They don't want that, you know. I mean, one man say, oh, boy, I'm going, I'm bright boy, I'm going like say, you know, I'm one with it. So they take a book from me, and when me listen, me hear them, I say, oh, yeah. You know, and some comment here, they say, tap, 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 tap. Yeah, I do. And me just take with myself, because me can't do that. Me agree, say, me can't do that. And me not do that. That is not going to happen. That will never happen because I have found my greater calling in Christ Jesus. And I refuse to allow myself. I refuse to allow myself to be based on sorts of things when I have my work and purpose to relate to. And I'm inviting my family to do the same. Amen. I heard Uncle Richie giving you a chant, you know? Sounds like what I would say. He says. In every situation you find yourself, chant that he says. You don't even have to open your mouth now. You just, in your mind, just thump it. He says. Jesus says from every and anything. Him save you even from yourself. Unbelief can cause you to talk around in circles. As we say, talk around the bush. And it's not, I'm not saying I never used to do some of them rubbish I may tell you about, you know. But when we find out, say, rubbish. Rubbish go where rubbish must go. Huh? Don't talk around the bush. Look, may I talk? I mean, can just tell you something. And we sit down right there so we can just talk about it and solve it. Why me go around the bush because me no want you feel bad? What kind of foolishness? And it's a diplomatic way of doing the thing and getting the cross. They say, somebody was dead and them say, and say, make pastor talk to the relative. And they want pastor to come and to say, one elder did say, him sick, him in the hospital. But I'm man dead, and him know, you know. And I try to tell him, I tell life, you know, no make the thing look bad. Say, but if you tell her straight, she go, she might dead too. I'm not responsible for who dies. Can I tell you this? I'm not responsible for who dies. When I tell you, sir, your mother dead. That's harsh, isn't it? Well, you see, ladies and gentlemen, I am teaching my congregation to be victorious in every situation. Take a stand to put death in perspective. Death is an employee because sin turn up. God employed death to work on that. that is not a friend of God, as you hear in Christianity. Right? It's not in the gifts. But sin is present. So that is implied to take you out because you have sin in your body. And when Jesus would have dealt with sin and finished the course, you don't need death no more to do no work. Eh? So death now is our enemy. Yeah, if you cannot come into the nice part, you are an enemy. You understand? If you are not counted in the majestic heaven, you're an enemy. That is why the scripture said that death is the last enemy, the final enemy. Because death no have no more use. Oh my God. As long as death was useful, death was being paid to take care of that situation. When Jesus closed the deal, you now have no more need for death. So death becomes an enemy. Don't hug up. I love the words to it. Love it. Don't hug up grief and become intimate with grief. And just, what are you doing? Intimacy means that when you're intimate, it means that you're going to go in further and no more. And that you want to? Well, like that. I see people are doing, and God, there they are. Hmm? It's a folklore. It's a practice, ancestorial practices, that when people die, they do all these fantastic things. And so it come down now to the part where the dancing bands are making a lot of money. You know that? If you don't have a dancing band, you know? You say, if your parent, if your relative die, you don't have no dancing band, then the neighbors go and look down on you. So you have to make up your mind now, sir. You know, who you going to please? Choose he this day, who will he please? The neighbors are the Lord Jesus Christ. Do you know that the scripture says something that don't go down so nice? It's even harsh too. Let the dead bury their dead. That is not Nancy Drew. It's not Shakespeare says so. It's the Bible. Let the dead bury their dead. And some of us walk in close because when you say, I can't serve in that capacity. I can't come to church because I have so and so and so and so and so and so for dealing. Tikya. When you talk, instead of talking around in circles, you would want to go to a better place. This is something I wanted to capture, like one of the great revelations. When you talk, you would want to go somewhere better with the talk. You don't just talk around for talk's sake. When you're talking, when you engage someone in a conversation, you want to go somewhere better. In other words, we loosely say we are seeking understanding. We want to know that when we finish talking, or in the middle of the talking, you know, if you're talking to Richie, you're going to get a suggestion as to what we solve that art, pay for that art, do whatever. You don't just talk to Richie. So hold on, let me say it right. You don't get to talk to Richie if you don't have no intention to find a solution. Huh? I talk about my big son, Richie. What you want to talk to Uncle Richie for? But because I like talking to him. No, you don't get to talk to him if you don't want a solution. You don't get to talk to him dragging him down into your grief. And likewise, there are some of our
some of our siblings, I'm going to call them. Some of them growing up into that. You understand? Not only me, Richie, the other ones of us. We have been talking for half an hour and we're not getting away out of it. Well, why are we talking? We don't do gossip. We want to talk to get ourselves better. We work in our best self when we talk. Somebody say, I don't want to talk to him because he's going to say, how you know what he's going to say? Just tell life on the man already and you don't know what he's going to say. Somebody tell me, people tell me that all the way. I didn't come to you because I know you're going to say so and so and so. My God, you're awesome. You know what I was going to say. And I don't even hear what I must suggest yet. Oh, bless the name of Jesus. Hallelujah to Jesus. The Lord is saying, listen to this. The Lord is saying, admire me for the authority. Admire me for my authority. It's not the time to doubt, wonder, guess, nor compete. You see, Peter and Jesus walking on the water. I grew up in circumstances, learning that Jesus walked on the water. Nobody no one accepts that Peter walk on the water. Because them can't walk on the water, them grudge Peter. And that is my conclusion to the matter. Because they cannot walk on the water, then grudge Peter. So me never hear nobody I preach nothing and I said Peter walk on the water. Them say Jesus walk on the water. Now me change that. That's folklore. Jesus and Peter was walking on the water. And we emphasize Peter Peter gazing and started to sink. But Peter walked from the boat. Come on, family. Peter walked from the boat to Jesus. Pan the water and never swim come out there. I refuse to be convinced to operate at a lower level just to make you feel good. Peter walked on the water, and when the overwhelming moment took place, him started to sink. But what did Peter do? Did Peter? No, hold on. Something that I don't think many people noticed. Peter was not a tax collector, I know. But Peter, what was Peter's profession? Huh? Now, could Peter swim? Let's look at the situation that we're dealing with. Somebody, somewhere we talk about the story, the nonsense we're talking of. Peter, could Peter swim? Peter could swim. So when Peter said, Lord, save me, what was Peter saying? Don't guess. Allow the Spirit of the Lord to reveal it to you. Peter said, Lord, save me. Peter was sinking. Peter was sinking and he reached out to Jesus, Lord, save me. Peter wasn't just asking the Lord, because he feel him like a John. Peter was asking the Lord for much more. Instead of cussing Peter right there, sir. Me never walk on the water. You walk on water? Eh? You walk on water? Instead of cussing Peter, God, get into the heart and studiousness of the real revelation. As to what Peter was asking God, Jesus for.
Peter was asking Jesus to give him the state that he has. So that him would not get overwhelmed and sink. That's what Peter was asking Jesus. Peter could swim. Prolific swimmer. Make a look at what we say in the man. And we stop just listening to old wise dopey story from people who don't know where they must. When some people bellow that this man and talk about it, they make it look like Peter couldn't forget how to swim. Huh? If you are up on water and you are sink, you know the swim. If that is what it is. But Peter said, Lord, save me. Peter put himself in Jesus' hand to say, give me that you have, that I can walk from over there, so come over there, so and don't sink. There are some things, family, that we can manage, that we are not wanting to manage. Because we are accepting that, as so them say, them, remember them? Yeah. We are accepting that them of lower level say, I saw it go. Well, I don't saw it go no more for me. I saw it go no more for me. You know, when I say I don't grieve, I feel good saying that. I do my due diligence. I ask the relevant questions. And somebody might say, I know you ask that, and you say you don't agree. I do my due diligence. I ask the relevant questions, find out what is what. And then I become very helpful in the situation. I don't have time to grieve. Because read the scripture. Make a note of it and read the scripture. We tell you already, says Isaiah. Right? The scripture say that he has taken our grief. That part we want to emphasize. He took it. Then if he take it. You know, a lot of people say, I'm making presentations and say, we all are sinners. I say, speak for yourself. When I commit sin, when I do something that equates to sin, I ask for forgiveness. So how you tell me, say, me a sinner? If me ask for forgiveness, I go me want go back in a state of not being a sinner. Just to make people, everybody don't feel too bad, they say, we all are sinners. Talk for yourself. And just like how I can see sin, do me due diligence, and kick it to where it belongs. It's the same way me can do with grief. Huh? You know, God never take away we mind from we now. All the things come to we mind as to, you know, and your process, do your due diligence, and rebuke it in the name of Jesus. That's why I make we able to talk. Because we have to talk to that blood of Jesus Christ against that. And as you talk to the Lord, look at him, give you a soothing word. And you know, say that done to where it belongs. Amen. Praise Jesus. We have found ourselves in a situation where we have to be in the world and working with certain systems of the world. But we are not of the world. We are not of the world. I have something else written down that I refuse to say right now because, you know, I don't want to say me too harsh because it's something that I have recently decided to walk by. And I'm doing it. But I'm not ready to tell you it. I'll tell you one later time. But you see, ladies and gentlemen, if we keep excusing ourselves from that ability that God is giving to us, our God is wanting to give to us, to walk in the valley of the shadow of death, fearing no evil.
Then we are just going, everybody a broom with. You know what? Hold on. Everybody know what broom weed is? Because I wouldn't see you, Stanley. What is broom weed? Somebody? Huh? Listen, country people, listen to me. Find out what broom weed is, and if you live in the country or at any time, there are some low growing weed that you pick a couple of them and use it as a broom for sweep up where you're sweeping up. I'm sure that the experts have a special name for it, which I don't know, and I don't necessarily want to know. But it's because you pick a couple of those, and when you have about 7 or 8 stalks in your hand, them just high above so. You hold it together, and it make a nice broom to sweep up different areas. Now, one other thing where when the artist said, all of we are broom weed, it means that we all come together in a common way to sweep up a yard. We all come together in a common way to do some things and whatever. Huh? So broom weed, oh, we are broom weed, oh. All of we are broom weed. Now, me not agree with him. Me not broom weed. Because you see that coming together thing there, it don't work like that, you know. Only the Spirit of the Lord God can unite a people, because it has to come from the heart. We could make arrangements at work and at school and everywhere we make arrangements. Somebody in the area is buried, so they say, come and try to spoil the show. It is always, what I am depending on from AWC, you know, is not that you love me, you know. Oops. I am not. Me now I'm buying a ticket and I don't want to love me, you know. And that's my thing is, you know. And that me I press for. I am pressing for every part, every member of AWC to love Jesus in a way that you obey everything him said. Why? Because it's Jesus going to call the shot, not me. You might say, you love me, I'm going to do something that you don't like and you don't love me no more. But if you love Jesus, me see if. So all I'm working for, and when I say I come, I live to give to you, I'm giving to you all that I can so you can stay in love with Jesus. If you stay in love with Jesus, we nice. So me and a broom weed and a broom weed that, broom weed time all itself together. It need one ugly hand to hold it together for sweep. And I did make a proclamation. Body of broom weed, but you need to be a quality conduit servant of the Lord. That broom weed need more broom weed to go with it for sweep up yard. But you have to have the quality. We have to have the quality where we can stand alone and still get the yard clean. Hallelujah. Praise the name of Jesus. Do not take down your standard to the base of salt and the bigger elements because you feel like you're nice, you have more heart than God. God said, the soul that sinneth shall surely die. Right, you know that for him? So you're going to see the soul that's in it? No. Our responsibility is the soul, that's it. We help to guide that soul to Jesus. Because if Jesus can't work out the program, the soul that's in it is going to go with the other guy. it sounds harsh, family, but it is only harsh when you disobey. It's only harsh when you have your own program. The blessings of the Lord make it rich,
and he addeth no sorrow with it. Stand with me, family. Put your hand on the church, please. Glory, hallelujah. Blessed be the name of Jesus. Father in heaven, we love you. We lift your name in all the earth, mighty God. We raise our hands and thoughts and hearts to you, my God, and we tell you thanks. Thanks for your heart. Thanks for the understanding heart of quick understanding. Thank you, mighty God, for the peace that passeth all human understanding. Thank you, mighty God, that you have raised the level to a limit, mighty God, to a measure, not a limit, a measure that, oh God, mighty God, we can relate to. So this day, mighty God, we stand in awe of your presence. We stand in awe of your tangible presence amongst us. And we rejoice in all that you have given to us and what we are able to give to others. We glorify your name. Bless this family, Lord. Bless this family and by extension, every area that export shall go to. Help us, mighty God, to export, mighty God, the ministry that we've come and we have seen and we are going to tell. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Amen. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Bless you, family. See you when I see you. Glory to God. Hallelujah. Glory to Jesus.
Hallelujah. I shall not die, but I shall live. Declaring. Hallelujah. We're going to start over that song. It's important that we're declaring. We're promulgating the gospel of peace. And we're exporting ministry. Hallelujah. And we're declaring that as we export and as we promulgate, we shall not die, we shall not grieve, we shall not fear. Hallelujah. So to wrap up this meeting today, we're declaring. Hallelujah.
I shall not die, but I shall live.
Declaring.
Declaring the goodness of my God.
No compromise.
In this day that he has made,
I shall
be glad, rejoicing in the fullness of his purpose.
Save everybody.
Save, Lord, I beseech thee.
Hallelujah. Transform us.
Save, Lord,
hallelujah.
I beseech thee. Send now, Lord,
prosperity.
Your prosperity.
Wealth, increase, power,
send
authority.
Now, Lord,
in the name
your
of Jesus.
Prosperity.
Hallelujah.
Yes.
Obedience is the key in finding out God's will and walking in the pleasure of his purpose, work and purpose. Hallelujah. Thank you, family, for your fellowship today. Hallelujah. I want to encourage you